see often the comeback in the Old Testament here in Genesis of the book of Esther. In Luke 16, maybe this is all certain. We're talking today about a subject that no one else thought about, and that's our giving. But especially going into Christmas season, it's something that we need to discuss. Now, if you're not a believer today, you can pass as far as it goes. However, know this, that if you ever take that step of faith, that one day this will affect you. And so this is something that we want to talk about with our kids, but we don't always necessarily talk about. We kind of teach it through an example. We kind of show as far as that goes. But the message about today is about our tithes and offerings. And if it's get it out of the way to begin with, that makes it easy on all of us. He brought an offering in today for me. He brought in this Mountain Dew, which is zero sugar. Mountain Dew kind of really had me. It's pretty good. And I took a look at this to make sure that I had the caffeine content. And then there's this caffeine content, 113 milligrams. Which, I don't know about you, but that means nothing to me. Because we're going to do that whole metric system and wait for you. So, I don't know what a milligram is, but that sounds good. And so, it's some good stuff. That's how sometimes we have things that kind of we talk over and we tend not to really talk about it. When it comes to the almighty dollar, which is really controlling our world, it tends to have a loose focus on the almighty. And so, that's a thing we've all heard in our lives, and that saying is money talks. So, if your money were to talk about you, what would it say? Now, before we get into that, every time you have a dollar, just pick a dollar, either $5, $10, whatever it is that you have in your wallet right now, or your purse, or whatever you carry with you, money is up your name. That dollar will touch 600 people this year. So you pass on to 600 people. So a normal dollar stays in somewhere in about 5.8 to 6.5 years, which is 6 years. So that dollar in circulation for 6 years will touch over 3,000 people and short of 4,000 people. So let's say 3,500 people. 3,500 people that dollar bill would touch. What would that dollar say about you, or that $5 bill say about you, or that $20 bill say about you? But what would it say about some of the other people that it comes in contact with? See, we get so focused so many times on the almighty dollar that we lose focus on the almighty dollar. It may say about you, you know what? You are a generous giver. It may say about you, you are a saver. It may say that you are a hoarder. It may say that you put me aside, and because you put me in a safe place in a mattress or in clothing or in a special place or a rainy day later, that you took me out of the circulation and didn't allow me to meet other people. What it says, though, about us says a lot about who we are as believers. So when you hear this message today, this is what I want to share with you. This message is not because of what I want to get from you. This message is not because of what the church wants to get from you. It's what God wants to give to you. Now, it's important as far as the beginning when it comes to the church, absolutely. It's because it's all with the bitters only, it's taking the meat balls and the kind of things. But that's for something for down the road. You know, we'd love to get to the point where we have enough here that we could be able to bring our youth pastor. It can't happen unless we take our giving seriously, both online and both in here, because you have to be able to raise enough to be able to bring someone on from the standpoint, from a staff standpoint. Now, as far as our church goes, society, the good that we are, we all know that we've had debt for a long, long time. God has handled that, and God will continue to handle that as long as we stay faithful. If you don't know, when I first got here to the church, we owed $1.145 million. In 4 years and 10 months after I was here, we owed $1.132 million. In other words, we got rid of $13,000 in debt in almost 5 years. Great job, right? It was because of a note that was signed by this church before we got here, and we were struck by it. And we were like, oh my goodness, what are we going to do? Because a month after that, we were going to be signing paperwork to continue to keep the loan, and it was going to cost us $26,000. In other words, the $13,000 that we had taken off in almost 5 years was going to double And we're going to lose that 13 and have another 13 to go. So we actually have had no debt covered. We would actually owe more than when I first got here. That's what we started into the bond program. And what happened with the bond program is we started into it in the last 7.5 years. We actually separated it. We took the money that we owed to a Christian organization and we split it and gave it to a worldly organization, and then we gave it to the believers on the other side of it. The cost of the believers was $400,000. That $400,000 today is zero. We don't owe it anymore. The $745,000 for the church debt is now down to $550,000. That's pretty good. Our $1.132 million now is down to $550,000. And that's great. And yet, somehow, we still struggle when it comes to covering our bills every month. That's why Patty and Lisa are putting it out to Tim as much right now, because that Tim originally was going to be for all kinds of different stuff depending on who you talk to. At the end of the day, it's a big building that's just there. It seems like this is a big building that takes them to get to use every Sunday, but for the most part, there's baseball teams, basketball teams, people rent it for different things. That's what next door is about. So we still have this debt that's over us, but it's not nearly as bad as what it was 7 years ago. I believe 100% that the reason that the debt has been required to where it is now is because this church chose to be faithful. Because what happened when I first got here is the Almighty power had gotten in the way of the Almighty, and they decided to dive into a $1.3 million project that they didn't have the money for. Why? Because they wanted to be like the next whatever. Take a church name. And then say that that's not who we are. It's okay to be a country church out in the middle of nowhere. And to be up on the side of the hill to be a high point and tell people to see that. There's nothing wrong with that. It's a great church with great people and it's done it for years and years and years. In fact, it's over 120 years now. There's nothing wrong with that. But sometimes we lose focus on God and we lose focus on the Almighty because of the Almighty dollar. And when that happens in the corporate church, it's easy for it to happen to us specifically. It's easy for that to happen to us when it comes to our everyday walk. It's just a natural thing that takes place. And guess what? It's been going on for like ever. So Jesus today is going to share a story with us. But before he does, I just want you to ask yourself that question again. Your money, if we were to talk about you, what would it say about you? What would it say about the things you're doing? That's how special it is. I was friends with Ian yesterday. I heard the saying a long time ago when it came to tithing. And my dad, he was 50 and a few, and you know, I always thought he was sleeping, but I found it like over the years, that's how he wore my produce and stuff, his eyes were actually closed, but somebody could take everything in and he knew everything was going on. But like, doing service to that, and I just agreed with him, and he was at the end, and his eyes were always closed, but when it came time for the offering, he reached in his pocket, he pulled out, he put the offering in a plate every single week. So I learned by his example, watching him do that. But we never had this discussion. And it's an important discussion to have for you about what it is that God's like to me. Because if your money would talk, what would he say about you when it comes to how you deal with it? And what is it we do that? But what we're going to learn today is that there's a difference between how a believer gives and there's a difference between how a non-believer gives. And the amazing thing is that non-believers are way better at it than the believers. Numbers go all over the place. So I'll be here a few as we go through. But here's what the problem is. Jesus had this discussion. But he didn't do chapter 16. He says this. Starting verse 13. No one can serve two masters, for you will hate one and love the other. You will be devoted to one and despise the other. So many times we get split when it comes to the things that isn't your devoted to. It's an example in every area of our life. When it comes to us, as far as relationships go, when we are married to someone, when we before that come before God, as long as we stay focused upon that person, with God first in that relationship, we should be fine. But what if we start to stray with our eyes, we start to look elsewhere, and we start to have conversations and text messages and things that we probably shouldn't have had, and we are never going that far, and actually, you know, we've got to move the line, move the line, move the line. And then, you know, this relationship that was ordained before God is in trouble because of this relationship that we compromised on. And it happens.
first time in the history of our country, married people are the minority. It happens. But the reason it happens is because we allow it, because we lose focus on God. And so, like Jesus said, you can't serve two masters. It makes sense. But the next thing he says is, you cannot love, you cannot serve both God and, if you fill in that blank, what would it be? Most of you can only take on the devil. You need to be on the devil's side. That's not what Jesus says. He says you cannot serve both God and money. Now, we don't think that money is an issue. We don't think it's a problem. No, it's Jesus spoke more about money than heaven. Why is that? Because he knew that the money we have here would be in the way of heaven. That we have at the end of this life. He knew how important our relationship with money was. That's why he spoke about money. He said, over 2,000 times, you have this stuff. But here's another amazing thing. You know what Jesus' money was saved by him? Nothing. You know why? There's only one time in the Bible where Jesus asked for money. And he said, hey, give me my coin. Give me my coin. Let me see this coin. You want to pay this tax? We all see this money. He's like, oh, that's great. And in some of the Bible, he gave it back to him. He just said, hey, I'm going to do, you know, I'm going to feed 5,000. I'm going to need a couple bucks from your offer. Everyone, you know, pass that thing around the door. We'll give you what's in these baskets. You fill these baskets. And yet he knew the importance of it because he knew your money. He knew my money would guess. And would put it in such a place that would affect all the relationships around us. So he's having this discussion. He's literally saying, hey, before we have this next thing, let's understand something. You cannot serve two masters. You cannot serve both God and money. And then he says this, the Pharisees, who dearly love their money, the Pharisees are the rich people. The Pharisees are all about themselves. The Pharisees sit on the corners and they put these horns and say, hey, look at me, I'm the Pharisees. I'm the God to pray. I'm the God to make all the rules. By the way, make sure you drop your offering in these big horns that we have here. I'm going to need that. It's all about me. The Pharisees, who dearly love their money, heard all this and scoffed at him. And he said to them, you like to appear righteous in public, but God knows your hearts. What the true honor is detestable in the sight of God. Now, see, that's right. I mean, we're just to start. But when we go to the backstory, maybe you can understand a little bit. Let's start in verse 1 and see how this discussion goes. Jesus is teaching, and he is teaching his disciples. He says, Jesus told this story to his disciples. Some rich man who had a manager handling his affairs. So this guy's got so much money, so this thing is going on, and he's like, I've got to hire somebody. We don't keep like this. You know, they have God, they have four or five other things that they're in, you know, so they're retiring for down the road, and it's for the time they're going to take to make these, because it's for vacation vouchers, for whatever it might be. And so they hire people that they know they can trust, but you oversee this and for this, you're just a pig. But the only thing you can get paid, and continue to get paid, as long as you are making new money. And so, those who are in the one venture, they'll go to the next venture, and they're going to hire this guy that they trust. They can make more and more and more money while they are doing the things that they want to do. That those guys are making that money. It's okay to do that. There's people that do that all over the world. There's nothing wrong to say, you know, with having money. It's how we treat that money and what we do with that money that God has blessed us with. He says, so rich, he's got people handling his money and his affairs. One day, a report came to the manager that the manager was wasting his employer's money. So the employer called him in and said, what did I hear about you? Put your report in order because you are going to be fired. In other words, you just won. This is your notice. The tax slip is coming. So you get an actual example of it. So the end of the month, you're done. We're going to figure out your retirement. We're going to figure out how long you've been here. We're going to figure out all the kind of stuff with money. And at the end of the month, you're done. So get your affairs in order. Make sure you get all the support from any of those examples. Make sure you drop them off this valley. Make sure you drop them off over here. Get this money to go to keep. Make sure you get this paper. So you have everything aligned so that we know. Because what you're doing is you are wasting my money. You are wasting the master's money. You only have a certain amount of time now. What will you do with it? And folks, I'm going to share some of the dangerous ones with the first one. Non-believers people go to church. People don't hear from God's word. People don't listen to the things that Jesus hears. Non-believers, on average, get 6% a year. So when we hear that, we think, well, if I'm a believer, because I'm a believer, that must mean that, you know, all the other believers out there, if you do the right way, you got to get 10, 15, 20%. Believers give 2%. Non-believers get 6%. Believers give 2%. If you were someone here today, you're like, man, I just don't know what God wants me to do. I don't know what God is taking me. I'm not really understanding this. Listen, if money is getting in the way of your relationship with your master, you're never going to find out. And Jesus is going to share that. We're going to learn more about it as well from the Old Testament. God has intended for us to be givers because he doesn't want our money to get us, but he wants to give us something special within that relationship. He wants to give us a release. He wants to say, hey, I've already blessed you, now go and bless others. So this guy now has his walking papers, and he knows that he knows he has a certain amount of time left. Guess what? We all do. No one that we know is freaking out of here alive, right? Except for Jesus died, once again, look at heaven. So we know as a believer that you're blessed. That there is a place that is special for us from an eternal standpoint. So the conversation continues. The man thought to himself, now what? My boss has fired me. I don't have the strength to dig with this, and I'm too proud to bank, so I don't have a very strong back. And quite frankly, I don't want to go off a manager, and also I'm not a manager, and people see me, they'll make fun of me. What am I going to do? Because it comes with the pleasure. But I know how to ensure that I'll have plenty of friends who will give me a home when I'm fired. We invite each person who owes money to his employer to come and discuss the situation. He asks the person, how much do you owe him? Man, if I owe him $800 of olive oil, which is like, needs to be this time. So the manager told him, take the bill and quit your teacher for $400. Why? Well, once again, when I'm fired, these guys will remember me. So now I'm going to cut this back and pay out. And then when I'm stuck, now I have someone go to, hey, you remember that? And we kind of wrote that thing off. And it's $800, then we took down to $400. That was me, and that was you. And, you know, $400 of olive oil is a lot. Maybe you can help down a little bit. And how much do you, the next guy comes in, he says, how much do you owe my employer? He asked the next man, I owe him $1,000 a week. What's the reply? Here, the manager said, take the bill and change it to 800 bushels. This is pulling this out. The manager knew that he was mismanaging his money. Jesus already heard that. And because he was mismanaging his money, he was wasting it. Because he was this one, whatever it is that made him look good, whatever it made him look rich, whatever it is that made him look like, hey, I'm something special for all of these people, all of the debtors. I'm losing my position. But now, he's doing the very thing that we will see as far as wasting it. But watch what happens next, because now the master knows about what's taking place. The rich man had to admire. The rich man, the guy that had the assets, had to admire the dishonest radical for being so shrewd. And it is true that the children of this world are more shrewd in dealing with the world around them than are the children of the light. What are you talking about? This message just went from, hey folks, those that are not believers, they get a pass. But the ones that are believers, they don't. I'm sitting with my disciples. This means you. Just because you're walking along with me, just because you're spending time with me, it doesn't give you a pass. The disciples were all bivocational. They all had jobs outside of it. They all had families they had to feed. They were married. They had something. They had all that stuff that you and I have to deal with. But what they were blessed with, and what they did with what they were blessed with, meant a lot to God. It meant everything to God. Because when it comes to a tithe, which means a tenth, God's asking for 10% from us. And yes, it is the first fruits, it's the beginning. When God gave, he gave his one and only son. He gave 100% to you. So God's just grateful to us. It seems pretty easy to give 10% back. So to believers, he gives two. To non-believers, though, they give six. And when they pass those people by, he gives two, and the biggest people in all the world, and yet they still give them what they have. There's something still missing. Because God doesn't turn in our hearts. People are noticing our money in the negotiations. They know where it is and what it is that we do with it. What's what I said about it, and it's talking about this first study, and the thing that the guy said was, hey, if you want to show me about how you are as a believer, then show me the good book. Your notes in the good book. Show me your checkbook. And it's like that at the end, and somebody gives me a deal. What's your checkbook? Well, what are you talking about? I don't even know what that is, right? And yet, we still have an offering plate that is here, because there's to be here because there's something special about the relationship with us, with God, and with us, and our money. God's money. It's where he came in. He says, here's the lesson. Use your worldly resources to benefit others and make friends. Then, when your earthly possessions are gone, they will welcome you to an eternal home. I'm not really sure what Jesus is going with this. Before I look, people have different ideas on what their thoughts are. This is what I know. I've always heard the saying, you can't take it with you. Have you ever heard that? No matter how much thinking, you can't take it with you, you can't take it with you, but I can't take it with me. Thank you. It makes sense then. My relationship with the stuff that I can't take means more than what it is that I have. Let's put it to you this way. Do you invest in things or do you invest in people? Because if you invest in things, you use people. If you invest in people, you use things. Either way, whatever it is you choose to invest in, when you die, whatever it is you had, stays here. But you and I get an eternal home. What does that eternal home look like for you and for me? When it comes to money, believers, we don't get a pass. When it comes to our possessions and things we have, we don't get a pass. God knows how important the relationship with our money is. Watch what Jesus says next. Verse 10. If you are faithful in the little things, you will be faithful in large ones. But if you are dishonest in the little things, you won't be honest with your responsibility. If you're untrustworthy about worldly wealth, who will trust you with the true riches of heaven? If you are not faithful with other people's things, why should you be trusted with the things of on your own? The reason we give the first use or the first fruits, the one reason we give the first fruits, is because if we don't get that right, the rest of our relationship with God can't be right. And here's the thing. If you have a little kid that you're teaching, and you're like, okay, listen, here, you made a dollar, so we're going to put 10 cents in the jar, and that's going to be your Jesus money. You should give our kids Jesus money. Here's a dollar, take a dollar, and give that every week. So they have these things. And the whole when they got older, they were trained right, and they would get it on their own, right? But you give them a dollar, if you were to take 10 cents, and you had an offering plate, you'd give them 10 cents, right? No big deal. Right? Right? Now they give you $10. You have no problem giving them a dollar. $10. You give $10. It's going out to bed, right? $1,000. You're going to have a $100 bill. That's what your dollar looks like, right? Okay, now, by the way, we're going to let the numbers start to feel it on the inside a little bit. Okay? Because now, you have $10,000. I'm going to let it drop $1,000 in. That's the first $1,000. Okay? $100,000. Who can even think about dropping $10,000 in? That's what a boss went from years and years and years ago. He literally called me on the phone one day. He said, hey, I just won like $2 million. He goes, hey, what's that damn thing where you got 15% or whatever you make? And I'm like, yeah. And he's like, he said, no matter what you make, you get 2%. I said, well, yeah, that's the time. That's what we're supposed to give. And he's like, me and my boss, who was your former boss, he just got promoted, I got promoted. He's making $250,000 a year. He's like, I'm making $160,000 my base salary now. He goes, that would mean that I'm getting $16,000. And he'd get $25,000. Well, yeah, that's what you should do. He's like, I had that discussion with him yesterday. We laughed and laughed and laughed. He said, what do you think of that? So you guys laugh and tell about it for eternity. That's what I hear these. I don't want the Almighty Dollar to get the land of Almighty. So when God says, it doesn't matter how much you get to give you to pay. If it's 100,000 he gave you, if it's a million he gave you, and now you're giving back 100,000, there's still 900,000 that you have to mess around with. Who's going to have that problem? God, if you had 10 million, would you love to have 9 million? And if they give the gift that money away, see, there's something that takes place with our money when we realize that our money can get us. But when we get to give it, and we get it first, it opens up our relationship completely with God. And here's the thing with every believer, and this is true from all the research, the last thing you'll do is give your money. The first thing you'll do when things aren't working exactly the way you want, if you'll take your money back. And that's not a relationship between you and your church, or you and someone else. That's a relationship between you and God. Even when you're angry, even when you're upset, even when things aren't going the way that you want them, that's your relationship with you and your Savior. And as a believer, we don't get the promise. Yet for some reason, every single time, it becomes an issue. Down to the point where we average getting 2%, then non-believer gets 6%. That should be painful for us. It should hurt a little bit. Now, I get it. Hey, you know what? You're making 25,000, so you gave 2,500. And you're making 40,000. You're giving 4,000. If you make 100,000, you're giving 10,000. That's when you're making 200,000. That's a lot of money. All of the 180,000 left over is due. Because guess what? You don't get the net of that 180,000 either. You're going to get 50 of it to the government, or 75 of it to the government. And guess what? You didn't decide to give that away. They took it from you. God is not forcing himself on you and taking it from you. He's allowing you to choose what it is that you will do with what he has left you with. The choice. But if you get in the way of the things that he trusts us with, do you want to allow that? Now, let's go to the backstory. Can I share with you? The backstory is the next story. And hopefully this will allow you to help you to understand just how important our relationship is with our money. Because if our money were to talk about us, hopefully that's what it's from the Old Testament of Malachi. Let's look to the Old Testament. Discussion we've had. Nice talking to prophets in the Old Testament. We're just discussing. And then you've got a full interview or two. And so I was like, all right, we'll figure this out later. Malachi chapter 3. Verse 7 says, ever since the days of your ancestors, if you've sworn by decrees and failed to obey them, I'll return to me and I will return to you, says the Lord of heaven's armies. But you ask, how can we return when we have never gone away? Because this is what happens when it comes to us in our mind. Might have a little bit of background question in here and there, and everyone's wrong, I'm bored of that, I'll donate to this. But do we do that for ourselves, or do we do that by taking the first of what we have to give to God to help others, to help support our local church, or it's young kids that are growing up that, quite frankly, within this church, they need a pastor. We have kids now that are coming to our church, they need a youth pastor. We don't have one. You're so lost one by this because of moral failings. So now, hopefully, we can get back to the point so we can get the people who are in the back helping and help some help so they can have someone that can focus upon the youth in our society. You know why? Because they need it. Because we need to be able to reach them. Because it's so important to reach out to them so they can reach the families so they can reach forward and we can continue that. We don't have it. We need it. Your kids need it. Your kids need it. My kids need it. Your grandkids need it. It has to start somewhere. So here's the discussion. How can we return then when we've never gone away? Verse 8, some people say, God, you have cheated me. But you ask, what do you mean? When do we ever cheat you? We can't even see it. We don't understand. We go along, we collect our paycheck, we collect our bonus, we collect our residual payment, we collect whatever must be. It's paid for Christmas, but then we got all this other stuff. Oh my God, I got a tax and that, and then we expect whatever might be. We don't think first about where it's going to go from God. We think about first about what it is that we can do with it. The next pair of shoes we can buy, the next nice thing we can have, and there's nothing wrong with any of those things unless we get in the way of how you are giving to God. Money to God is the small stuff. It's the little things that Jesus talked about. Because none of us are taking notes. Because it's so important to me that God would say, hey, listen, good job down there, but I don't want to take it back. God really wasn't. God doesn't do that. He leaves it behind because it's all just going to rust away anyway. It's not bad. There's nothing wrong with having money, but when the love of that money, when you serve that money, it takes away the relationship with God, no matter how much or how little you make. You have cheated me for the tithes and offerings due to me. Let's stop here for a moment. I'm not going to ask you either. I'm not going to give you a piece of equipment. But if I was saying, how many of you give 10%? So, when we first got this group, we were struggling with debt. The reason that I believe that God watched over this our church is because we flat out said, we're not teaching, but we're talking about money. We're not having this discussion about it. I'm not giving up on this pulpit. I'm not giving up in preaching until whatever it is that comes in offering next week, 10% of it goes to the missions. And the guys looked at me, and this, the first thing is that six guys, all of them agreed. Didn't even like to talk about it. Because, I mean, if I could fight the whole time, I think this way, I think that way, I think we can survive when our skulls are bigger and we're dumber than fuck, that's what I'm saying. So I had to help us get some women, particularly that woman, who was like, amen, amen, right? But they looked at something we liked, and all of a sudden, the almighty dollar comes up, and all of a sudden, they became close friends, like the male bottom of the unit took place. That 10% of whatever comes in next week goes to missions. Because they said you're an outreach for the missions church. And they said this, I will never forget. We can't afford to do that. Some of your things, your tithes, your offering, we can't afford to do that. That is because you put God last. When you change and you put Him first, it's a whole new ballgame. I'm not here to throw you in the air again. Talk about what? 10% to God, you come to teach. 30%, you know, 40%, now you're down to 60%. If you live on 50%, you still need a 10% margin. We all live on margin. The average person in the United States lives on 104% of what they make. There's a problem with that, because the governor's taking 25 to 30. You're a couple of ways to make that problem. Yes, in the way of your relationship with God. But here's the bullshit line. If I can share with you right now, if you only have to give one third of what you think you have to give, would you give it? It's not like we're like on a commercial now, right? Hey, you don't have to do this, you're missing 5 times. You give the word for sure. A biblical tithe is 10% of what you get whenever you get paid. So some of you are like, I have to get every week. You can do it when God pays you, that's fine. You get paid for the week, you get paid for the week, it's 10%. But also add an offering that you have to get every 3 months on top of it. There's another tithe. There's another one that you had to give every year, which was another tithe. There's another one that you had to give every 3 years, which is another tithe, based on what you had. And so by the time you got done, a biblical tithe is 26 to 28%. What's that sound like? So now, if I said to you, hey, I'm going to get 26 to 28% of what you made, you're like, I promise all, I'm going to get you a 10, okay? Sign me up. Just get 10. Start with, go from 2 to 4. Go from 4 to 5. Go from 5 to 4. Whatever it is, it's going to make you comfortable. Because that's not a relationship between you and me, or you and your money, because that's what your money can't talk. But we know that. But God can speak into your lives. When you start to get to him first, especially when you start with that 10, when you start to hand it over, there's something that changes within you, but you have to start. You have to pick a place as far as that goes. Watch the next thing that God says, bring all the tithes into the storehouse, so there will be enough food in my table. If you do, says the Lord of heaven's armies, I will open the windows of heaven for you. I'm going to stop here for a second. Bring every week. I put money in my pocket to put in here. To bring it. The reason I bring it is because I want to feel that release. God, the church family for around 120 years, we've got different missions that we didn't have even 10 years ago. We're reaching people that we never thought we would reach. You're going to learn about this next week. But the missionary is coming in. When you hear what's going on there, better come back. Whoever's online, get your butt here. Goodbye, friend. I'm not kidding. But there's something that takes place when you do this. By the way, some of us have 15 miles in the there's something that takes place within you when you do this. And guess what? God blessed you with that amount. Now, some of you're like, okay, well, you know, I'll give online. Well, how fair do you give online? My friend came in today and he's like, oh, you're like, well, what are you talking about? Well, I'm talking about giving. I don't know, that's okay. Give online, big enough. You don't have excuse. You can give online. So, you can go and put a picture that is a recurring payment, weekly, monthly, every whatever. But here's the thing that happens. When you do that, it's gone. It's gone because it's God's. But when you don't, you will hoard it. You will keep it. You will save it. You will put it away. Nothing wrong with having those savings, but it's a saving part of God's 10%. It's a saving part of the 90% that you left you. Because at the end of the day, you and I, when we don't choose to do this, when we don't bring this with us, we are robbing ourselves. We're robbing God. When we're robbing God, we are robbing the relationship that we have with a loving God who gave 100% to you and to me. If that hurts a little bit, fine. It doesn't bother me at all. But I'm telling you, this changed our lives. It changed everything about our relationship with God because I was giving God the leftovers. But thankfully, I had a wife who said, give the first, that's what it's called, the first fruits. Here's the coolest part of this whole message. Watch what God says next. I will pour out a blessing so great, they not would like to be like, oh, we're going to make more money, oh, we're going to win the lottery, and we're going to, whatever it might be, we're going to go to school, blah, blah, blah. Here's a blessing. You need to put a dollar amount on that blessing. You can't put dollar amounts on blessings. I will pour out a blessing so great, you won't have enough room to take it in. And then God says this. Try it. Put me to the test. Go and try it. When you are blessed with something, you bring it to me first. When you send it first, whether it's a ministry, whatever it might be, you do it first. When you're putting it online, when you're putting it in every single week, you do it first. If you have something that God has put in your life that you believe in, or you see something that someone's doing that's helping the Lord that you believe in, give to it first. And watch what God does to your heart. If you don't believe it, it's the only time he says it. He says, try me. Do I need to put me to the test? Why would God say that? Because God knew the very first thing that you and I should do in our everyday walk as a believer is that we should give back to him. And he's only asking for 10%. Even though the Bible says 26%, he's only asking for 10%. When you do this, not if you do this, when you put this to the test, all of a sudden it creates within you a sign of generosity. Yeah, I'm going to 10% here, but hold on to this. I jumped in here, I joined over here, and now I'm starting to help others, and now I'm starting to be a part of it. It might send you on a mission trip, it might send you into a mission field, it might send you into volunteering more. God, stop this, God, stop this, God, stop this. He's had it all along. Your money and my money, we don't take with us. It's a little stuff to be able to get, no matter how much money you have. But that's what a relationship with God begins. It's a step of faith, and then it's a continued step of faith. It's up to you and it's up to me. And do that to test God in it. So have a conversation with him. Try it. Try it. Bring your tithes and your offerings. See the blessings that God does with you, through you, and for you. Let me say this by the way, close your eyes. I asked you way back in the day how much you made. Some of you, minimum wage at one point was under $3. Some of you, minimum wage is $3. Now, minimum wage, I know it is $8.7. I was trying to go for $16 on stuff. Over time, the wages have gone up, your wages have gone up, and God has trusted you with more and more and more. Where is it that all of a sudden we got to change? It's not about what we have, it's about the relationship with a God that loves us so much that is standing in the way of that. We live in a country that we are so blessed. We have so much we don't even realize it. To you. Think about just this week, next week, the week after, we're going to talk about the Christmas service that's coming up. How many of you are waiting for something from Amazon or some of you get three packages from Amazon? You don't even know what's inside it. What do we order? What's going on? It's well on the boom yet. We got 2 days. Pretty big. Because we're blessed. You stop and say, thank you, God, that you bless you with whatever it is in this cardboard box with a smiley face on it. It's not about what we have, it's about what we do with what we have. And the general relationship that we have with God starts with this. Some of you are going, yes, so we can get this church, we can get the ministry, we can get the people there, all that kind of stuff. No. God wants to give you a peace through this. He wants to give you a release through this. He wants to pour so many blessings out on you that you will put this aside. And you'll be thankful. And you'll be grateful for what it is that God has given you. And it will start to affect your generosity in every area of your life. Because it's just money. You can never say, it's just my spouse. It's just my daughter. It's just my son. It's just my grandkids. It's just their friends. It's just Christmas outreach. It's just a Thanksgiving meal. It's an opportunity to bless others because God has blessed us. The Heavenly Father, whatever that looks like in our lives, Lord, it's easy to feel guilty at this point if we're not giving. But God wants to throw us out. You want to pour blessings out on us. You want to. You can control the attack. There are ministries out there, there are churches out there, there are people that are in need, that we can help. There are ministries we have here inside of our church that we can help others. Help us to take what it is that you bless us with and make a choice to help others. Choose to take the Almighty dollar and have it bless others because of our relationship with the Almighty. And help us to know that when we do that, there's a release that takes place. The Lord, it changes us, it changes our hearts, it changes who we are from the inside out. And the more that we do that, the more it breaks the bonds. The money that we have, it helps us to focus more on the relationship that we have with you. Lord, thank you for this time together today. Lord, help us to take our first step with you. Lord, help us to see, to feel, to know the blessings. God, I love you. Thank you for tonight together. And you get to be in that focus. Each week we somebody that's been a while, maybe someone that is in your family, and neighbor, whatever it might be. Great time to time of the year, people need light. They need Jesus. So let's not wait for Christmas to get them by them. Let's do some next week. All right? And let's do some things at hand. We hope you're good. Have a great Lord's Day. Your sins have a great day. We'll see you next week.
This morning, on the center table, there is communion if you wish to practice during the worship service, and you can also leave your tithing there as well if you desire. I have a few announcements for you. First of all, we are now accepting donations for the Hope Outreach Center. If you would like to contribute, donate new or slightly used gloves, jackets, boots, blankets, anything to help keep the homeless man, we would appreciate them. There's a donation box out in the front entrance, or you can see Mr. Dawn for further information. Also, our Bible studies are back on track this week. Your vacation is over. Wednesday night is co-ed Bible study. Thursday night is the separate men and women's study. All Bible studies are 6:30 to 8:30. I'm sorry, 8:30. And we would love to have you here to join us. This Friday, December 13th, Christmas is coming, and I'm about to be. We are going to Bethlehem. If you would like to journey to Bethlehem with us, down at Homer Creek, this is a free event that is put on by the Amish community. We're going to meet here at the church at 3 o'clock and carpool down. Be prepared. This is a free event, but it is an outdoor event. You will need stay warm, dress accordingly, and there is plenty to walk. But we would love to have you join us for that event. I have been asked, are we going to get anything to eat while we're out on our journey? Of course, if we decide we want to stop and eat, we can all decide what we want to do that night, but we're never going to let you starve. I don't think you can even strip this long and naughty to starve to death. We will figure out what we're doing that night, but we'll just have a good time and enjoy it. This Saturday, now to be in Christmas spirit, because you went to Bethlehem, come to the church at 9 o'clock. You can join us in coffee and check the walls of the church. We would love to have your help with that as well. Sunday, December 5th, is a big event here at the church. We're doing our church-wide baptism. The list is getting longer. If you would like to be baptized to follow the obedience to Jesus, please contact the church office. Our Christmas Eve service is December 24th at 6 p.m. We would like to have you here. We will be having a sermon for Pastor John, and then we will light candles and sing silently. Thank you for coming tonight. Enjoy the rest of the service.